it's the first Mini to drive since 2014. And by that I mean the true Mini Cooper, number 4-door, Countryman, Clubman, or anything paceman. Officially, it's a 2021 Mini Cooper S hardtop 2-door, but come on, it's a Mini. The original, or rather, a recreation of the original. This is a car that gives birth to and inspires others, bringing character and customization to the cookie-cutter and off-the-lot industries, which allows small cars to be cool. Sure, it's a mid-cycle update from the third generation, but I'm happy to report right away that despite the weight gain, the Mini still feels like a Mini. It's still tight, small and easy to throw from corner to corner. It's also impeccably structured, without the problems at heavy loads that normally plague chassis. Steering feels tight and responsive in the center, although it has sadly been the case since the second generation, pressing the sport button at startup is a must to satisfy that well-worn go-kart feel cliché. Ditto to get just the right throttle response. The sophisticated, expertly tuned suspension is not only up to whatever task is thrown at it, it provides a sturdy yet compliant ride. Perhaps this speaks volumes more about the advancements in run-flat tire technology over the years, but for those who remember the older Mini's reborns, especially the Flintstones mounts from the first generation, this will definitely be the pinnacle of the latest iteration. The Cooper S engine has always been a treat. The base engine isn't that great, although it's currently very good. Right now the 2.0-liter turbo inline 4 is good for 192 horsepower and 206 pound-feet of torque, and frankly, that's overkill for a small front-wheel drive car like this. Hello torque steering. This will pull the wheel in a straight line and as it exits corners. I've never driven a 231 HP John Cooper Works, but that must be bullshit. Will it stick with Cooper's small inline 3 turbo? Maybe. Either way, it's going to have a 6-speed manual transmission like this one, and if you think about the last time I drove a proper Mini with one of these, it's probably going back to the Bush administration. Maybe that says more about the availability of press vehicles and riding assignments over the years, but this drought also seems pretty much indicative of a brand that has spent years evolving beyond its original recreation into new sizes and segments. The general concept of it is understandable. People are bound to tackle a 2-door subcompact with a rinky-dink trunk. Providing something bigger with the same core attributes of agile handling and unique character makes a lot of sense. It's good for the company that sells it and it's also great for the customer. Can still have a Mini even if it's not a Mini. However, it's hard not to think that BMW hasn't put in enough effort to ensure that the Mini remains in demand and relevant enough to bring in new people. Oh, it adds the necessary infotainment and safety features, and refines engineering to ensure each version is generally better than the last. However, like many brand extension models, the effort is largely aimed at retaining existing customers. There's really nothing innovative in terms of feature content or design to attract new people. And no, the Union Jack on the taillights and dashboard isn't that innovative. They are a little indulgent and smell like a brand out of ideas. Mini used to have lots of ideas. Most are funny. Switch. High-sized speedometer in the center of the car. Scottish or Puerto Rico flag sticker on the roof. Ambient lighting before everyone had it. A chorus of characters who will say fun things while driving, from fastening your seatbelt to taking quick turns. Seriously, you can get that in the 2010 Mini Cooper Camden and Mayfair editions. Some of these things still exist, part that distinguishes the Mini brand. Well, not Mini Mission Control. As such, stepping up to the newest Mini after a generation and years of modeling makes it feel like it never left. That may be entertaining, but that's also part of the problem. To anyone who isn't enthusiastic, nostalgic, or at least familiar with the Mini shtick, this car is sure to seem odd. Mostly talking about interiors here. There are too many places that it seems, perhaps deserved, to be refitted. Digital instrument pod with blurry resolution that doesn't match the center screen. The center console's infotainment controls are essentially iDrive Mini-fied, but located so low and so far back they're basically useless. And then, perhaps worst of all, the Mini actually puts a square peg in a round hole. The infotainment touchscreen that sits in the vestigial dash.
Thank you.